Welcome once again to History Today.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of History Today. I'm your host, Gwendolyn Bruce-Netterton, and today we'll be solving a mystery as old as time. Why did Germans never laugh? And why do Britons never stop? To get into the nitty-gritty of this pressing issue, we're going to explore two examples of Anglo-German comic exchange. Comedy imports so beloved in their new homes, but utterly unheard of in their native countries. One of Britain's most celebrated stand-up comedians is the self-styled German comedy ambassador. Ah, Henning, you're so vain. Brits, specifically the English, seem to love Henning Wehn, with his Cockney-infused German accent, sensible shoes and stopwatch. His persona incorporates everything we love and hate about these Teutonic cousins. And Henning, of course, simply cannot go without mentioning the elephant tank in the room, World War II. This cultural exchange goes both ways, however. Germany has no problem claiming Shakespeare, who's considered a German national poet, rock band The Beatles, and perhaps most inexplicably, a relatively unknown slapstick 1960s sketch, Dinner for One. This sketch, performed by British comic Freddie Frinton for German television, will be our second focus for today.
No. Actually, the sketch's author, Laurie Wiley, wrote it in the 1920s and Frinton performed it as early as 1945, not the 60s.
Well, it seems he's already introduced himself. I am joined today by Daniel Penry Benweathers, Warwick history student and founder of the r/Teutonic Race subreddit, which is nice. Our second guest is Cormac O'Grady, an anthropology lecturer at Oxford University.
Grand, thanks for having me.
And to give the illusion of balance, we're joined by Jürgen Schwanzlecker.
Hello.
Whose qualifications include being a German. Cormac, what makes Brits laugh?
Yeah, thanks for having me. For me, as an Irishman and a historian, I'd say British humour is wide-ranging. There's satire, absurdity, the mundane, the macabre, surrealism, embarrassment, bullying, sarcasm and stereotype. So it's certainly interesting that this outmoded slapstick humour is the one that stuck about in Germany.
Well, it's very funny. There's a man falling down and then he's falling down again. This is classic humour.
Well, it's clear there's lots that sets us apart.
But culturally, there's a lot that links these two countries. Tradition, Christmas, religion, language, location, even temperament.
Yeah, like even old notions of ethnicity tending to group the English with the Germans. I actually just wrote a subreddit about this. If you just like take a look at the ethnographic maps of Europe from Germany and Britain in the 1880s, you'll see how rigidly ethnicity was tied to language rather than location. So an historian can conclude that speaking a language seems to be the main factor in defining Teutonic heritage.
Yeah, but obviously such ideas are outdated and racist now.
We're just bitter not to be part of the gang.
Better watch yourself there, laddie.
Okay, well, football is something that has brought our countries close together. Christmas 1914, a football brought together the bitterest of enemies and brought to us this level of humanity to what otherwise is this faceless, anonymous bath of blood.
But then for the last 57 years, football has torn you lots apart.
Two World Wars and one World Cup. Doo-dah, doo-dah.
Clearly, the two countries have got a lot that tie them together. Maybe that's why they fell out. You only really fall out with the people you've got stuff in common with, right?
I usually fall out with people I can't stand, to be honest with you.
With this subject matter, I'm immediately reminded of the famous German baby joke. A British couple decided to adopt a German baby. Years and years went by and the child functioned perfectly normally, except for the fact that he never spoke. And then one day when the child was 8 years old, he had a bowl of soup. And he said, "This soup is a little tepid, mother." And his parents, of course, shocked that he was suddenly speaking, asked, "Wolfgang, why have you never spoken before?" To which the child replied, "Up until now, everything had been satisfactory."
I like that one.
This is a very sensible child.
See, this is like a clear example of how the Germans don't have a sense of humour. The German language simply isn't built for a pullback and reveal gag like that. Stuart Lee, a stand-up comedian and friend of Henning Wehn, wrote about this, saying that the flexibility of the English language allows us to imagine that we are an inherently witty nation when, in fact, we just have a vocabulary and a grammar that allows for endlessly amusing confusions of meaning, you know?
There's this concept that preys on the minds of the non-German speakers, always banging on about the verb goes to the end. It's such a huge thing that comedians and writers mention when musing about the German language. The verb always goes to the end, which a totally, utterly ridiculous notion is.
It's always said with such conviction. It's such an English elitist humor thing, even from comics like Stuart Lee and Al Murray, who have an appreciation for Germany. This idea that the English language is just more malleable and inherently funnier.
There are a lot of famous examples of the German language functioning just like that, like the beginning of Kafka's Metamorphosis or that Mark Twain essay.
Yeah, but like, English has a way broader vocabulary than basically any other language in the world. There's no room auf Deutsch for double or triple meanings because of compound nouns.
Yeah, but in any language, the bones of the grammar and the structure and the reason have to be broken in order to craft jokes. And English, just like German, creates its own compound nouns. It is Wahnsinn that you Brits pride yourselves on humor so dry and sarcastic that foreigners couldn't possibly understand your taking the piss. And yet, we Germans do have a sense of humor. Yeah, self-deprecating humor is non-existent in Germany because it is weird and tragic to knock yourself down. We are not losers.
Duda, duda.
We already experience viel zu viel Fremdscham. Instead, in Germany, we have extreme sarcasmus. There is no indication that someone is being sarcastic, no change in pronunciation, no change in intonation. And you Brits just don't get this sense of humor. I've also noticed, as an Irishman, that for Germans, humor is a private thing reserved for people you feel comfortable with, those you love, a form of intimacy.
Yeah, I suppose for Brits, specifically the English, there's this absolute torture and mortification you feel when you meet new people, like being in new environments. And so you like immediately resort straight to the gags to calm yourself down, to grasp the reins of the situation. You know, you're like, you're diffusing an otherwise like agonizingly awkward feeling. But then once you get to know someone and you feel comfortable, you can be sincere and earnest. This is a complete reversal of the German way of being, you know?
Humor and comedy is utterly infused into the very DNA of Britishness. It's unavoidable, inescapable, and capitalizable. And in job adverts, dating profiles, you'll see good sense of humor. Even politicians get slated for lacking a sense of humor. Think Gordon Brown.
Yeah, the entertainment industry related to laughter is well established in Britain as well. In fact, there are comedy clubs in even the tiniest towns. Even for children, that's a distinctly British notion that even children must be taught how to appreciate comedy. And you say we have no sense of humor. You all sing the praises of a stand-up comedian who cashes in a quick buck from lazy, outdated stereotypes of what it means to be the German.
Certainly a perspective. Well, here's how Henning Wehn himself describes his work.
I think when I do social commentary in the style of classical political cabaret, most of my jokes are blunt statements, which I subvert with a twinkle of my eye. So that's how I describe what I do. Everybody else here in the UK describes me, oh yeah, him, that German bloke.
Ach, scheiße. Every night he walks on the stage, he introduces himself as the German comedy ambassador, and he starts the stopwatch.
And every night, it's hilarious.
Makes me laugh every time.
His stand-up is rife with astute observations. He deliberately mixes a strong accent with British idiom, slang, and grammatical errors that have entered common parlance to create this over-the-top character. He lulls audiences into this false sense of British superiority with gags about football and language before pulling the rug out from underneath them and holding the mirror back to the British public. He reveals this hypocrisy in politics, class, Brexit, colonial history, racism.
And the entire show works because Brits have these, like, notions about Germans, but Henning also admits that he'd be totally out of work if German stereotypes and football went out of fashion. On the surface, a lot of comedy only works if the reference points are shared, which is an important point for an historian to note. And so Henning's act would never have worked in Germany because it's specifically written for Brits.
Because you Brits have these insane notions about who we are. If you were to walk on stage to an audience of Germans and bang on about how much we all love the Hof, we would look at you as if you had lost your marbles. And don't even get me started on the war. The war. This idea of the Second World War as the war is an incredibly British idea, despite the fact your country has been involved in dozens of wars since.
For English people, Germany is still, for the most part, synonymous with Hitler. It's the easiest joke, the lowest hanging fruit. There's a certain tendency to focus on the Tommies rallying together against Herr Hitler and ignoring the suffering of millions of people targeted by the Nazis based on their ethnicity.
Because that's not funny, but a silly little screaming man with a comb over and a moustache is hilarious.
Yeah.
Even the slightest hint of anything German in Britain raises a snigger. And the idea of the fascist titans of Nazi Germany being single-handedly defeated by Mr. Churchill and his boys, now that's a story worth telling, worth repeating.
I think for Brits, the attraction of Dub Dub 2 is that no one can argue you weren't the good guys for once. As an Irishman, I'd say it allows you to frame Britain as the goodies and Germany as almost comic book villains with evil mad scientists like Mengele and goose-stepping dictators.
At least we actually fought in the war.
You picked up a gun for king and country, did you, Egypt?
How dare you?
So wie ich das sehe, Britain still seems to see Germany as a rival, but the truth is we do not think about you at all. In football, our nemesis is the Netherlands.
Sort of like how Ireland feels about us.
Watch it. Perhaps modern Britain is still infused with this idea of Germany as the cousin gone bad and Britain as this shining beacon of what Germany could have been had they not gone wrong, so to speak.
And that reflects the historical British self-image of Britain as this long-standing, never-waving empire versus the ever-changing Germany. In the space of 100 years, Germany had been a group of small states, then an empire, then a republic, then a fascist dictatorship, then a communist dictatorship. Perhaps such British ideas of bizarre Germany live on in Henning's stand-up. Which brings us on to the British comedy sketch that's made its way into the New Year's celebrations of Germans for decades, Dinner for One. In the UK, unless you studied German at school or happened to catch that one episode of QA, you'd be completely in the dark about it.
I think the reason it's successful in Germany and not in the UK is because it isn't funny.
Doch!
For those not clued up, Dinner for One features the character of Miss Sophie, played by Mae Warden, who is celebrating her 90th birthday. As is her tradition, her four closest friends, Sir Toby, Admiral von Schneider, Mr. Pomeroy and Mr. Winterbottom, all eat dinner. However, they've all been dead for at least 25 years. So consequently, Miss Sophie eats alone, while her butler James, played by Freddie Frinton, impersonates each of the guests in turn. As well as serving the food, James the butler assumes each guest's persona, toasts Sophie and drinks each drink. So throughout the sketch, James circles the table 23 times, consuming 15 glasses of alcohol, becoming increasingly intoxicated and hilarity ensues. And from this, we get the iconic line.
The same procedure as last year, Miss Sophie?
The same procedure as every year, James.
Like a lot of comedy, the sketch provides a community, a shared culture. In various countries around the world, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Estonia, Australia, South Africa, Norway. But nowhere is the sketch more well-known and more culturally embedded than in Germany. It's been parodied to death. There's even been protests when the sketch wasn't broadcast.
Pretty jiggy.
Yeah, every Sylvester, every New Year's Eve, Dinner for One is playing. It is a very funny film for us, you know. We are laughing, and then the fun is done. It is the New Year. German Kinder grow up watching this, not understanding what is going on, and as you grow up, you develop the better skills in English, you understand more and more the plots. We have, in fact, a word for this in German, das Jugendliche Erwachsenwerden, Überbrückungsphase fest. I think maybe in English you translate to rite of passage.
So once again, it comes back to language and how it connects us. As we discussed, Henning Wehn's use of idiom and colloquial British English draws his audiences in, and he splices this together with the kind of German that Brits know and love. Jawohl.
Exactly. The dialogue in Dinner for One is completely English, but because of the visual humor, repetition, and exaggerated upper class stereotyping, is pretty understandable for viewers everywhere. And the stiff social setting is juxtaposed with the hyperbolic personalities of the characters and the surrealism of the scenario.
So Germans are clinging on to this super characterized, offensive, lazy stereotype. Britain's a forward thinking country. We tolerate foreigners now.
It is said that Freddie Frinton didn't really want to perform in Germany because he had fought in the World War II. He was prejudiced against the Germans and actually refused to perform the sketch in the German language. It is the same association of Germany with the Nazism that lives on today, not just in the generation of Frinton, but every single generation thereafter.
With that in mind, why has it resonated with the Germans so much?
I mean, it's not funny, but the so-called comedy comes from repetition and then the breaking of that repetition.
On the basic level, yeah, but every year I rediscover some very small detail I had forgotten. It took me, for example, many years to understand the raunchy implications of the final lines of the sketch. When you get a little bit older, it can be the fun drinking game. And the fact that it is broadcast every year makes us, the Germans, part of the joke. It is literally the same procedure every year.
Grand.
Professor Rainer Stolman, a laughter researcher from Bremen, argued that the sketch resonates with German audiences because of its precarious boundary between life and death, between past and present, and through this facade they can laugh about the Third Reich. He also believes viewers of the sketch are dying out as young people don't watch it anywhere near as much as the older generation. And finally, he argues that the sketch is not popular in Britain because Brits don't have a sense of humour, are too stiff, and the sketch is dangerously revolutionary undertones might upset Britain's delicate class system.
My God.
Yeah, okay, this is
no
ridiculous.
That's mad.
That is a fundamental misunderstanding of British humour and culture and, like, absolutely hilarious to hear. That's so German.
To be sure, I have to agree. Come on, this is a history program and you're citing some guy who's studying laughter as the authority.
Especially because King Prince Charles himself has cited Dinner for One and Henning Wehn as positive examples of modern Anglo-German cultural exchange.
This is why the history of comedy and its part in Anglo-German relations is so hard to measure. It's always been seen as a lesser form of art.
Like all flavors of history, methods of study and data collection over time have been flimsy at the best of times. As an Irish historian, I have to navigate written sources, which are often by higher status men, while writings and artifacts not considered important would not get saved or would disintegrate or get lost. The nature of comedy, a particularly oral tradition, means it's so subject to change as well.
Yeah, it's a kind of like Chinese whispers effect.
Oh. You can't say that, can you? Can he say that?
I'm being told by our producers that you indeed cannot say that.
What? You can't even say that now? Bloody BBC loony leftist PC gone mad, if you ask me.
Well, no one did ask you, Aegis. Anyway, that's not the point. Oral tradition is subject to change. Race, class, gender, location, and numerous other factors can influence the version of a piece of oral tradition you encounter. But instead of just seeing the differences between German and English comedy, it's important for a historian to see these different spheres interact and study the exchange that's produced from such an interaction, like the phenomena of Henning Wehn or Dinner for One.
And the historian...
Yeah, yeah. For me, it is a simple thing. The problem is that the British glorifies a sense of humour whilst claiming that we Germans do not even have one. British people want to feel superior to us, but in a lot of ways we are better than you.
So is Britain continuing this Teutonic fraternal rivalry spirit?
No. It's the Germans continuing the tradition of the two countries as like antonyms. This obsessive repetition of an old rubbish British sketch is the Krauts clinging on to this old-fashioned hoity-toity rigid class-based society, the way a lot of the world still sees us. Bullingdon Club, soggy biscuit, penny-farthing riding poshos.
I'm sure it must be really hard for you to make your way in the world with such outdated, offensive stereotypes.
Well, as you come here, then
I'm talking to me. Well, I had full hands. Nein. I'm coming for you, son.
Step away.
Was hast du gesagt? Bollock. English.
Hat dir jemand ins Hirn geschissen und vergessen, um zu ruhen?
Uch. Perhaps modern-day Germans and Englishmen are like each other in many ways, completely out of touch with one another, just like they've always been, fixated on an idealized, hyperbolic version of the other, like the gothic, pumpernickel Germany the Victorians dreamed of. Maybe that's just human nature. Or maybe that's just men. Clearly, the Germans and the English have had a mutual admiration, whether they like to admit it or not. This relationship has at times been familial and at times been antagonistic, but they just can't seem to give each other up. Certainly a lot for an historian to deal with.
A historian.
Right, I think we'll leave it there. Thank you to Daniel Penry Benweathers, Jürgen Schwanzlecker, and Cormac O'Grady, who is, as we've discovered, an Irishman. I've been Gwendolyn Bruce Netterton. And you've been listening to
History Today.
Good night. Stupid Mick. Fucking hell.